Well, always look on the bright side of life was the mantra of these two world-famous comedians. And now John Cleese and Eric Idle are back live and on stage, but they may just have met their match because we, don't know why, allowed Jono out to catch up with these legends of comedy.
It was 1963 when a 23-year-old John Cleese met a 19-year-old Eric Idle in the hallowed halls of Cambridge University. Throw in a few more years, a few more funny guys, and Monty Python is born. The Monty Python phenomenon spawned a number of very successful TV shows.
This is an ex-parrot!
Feature films.
He's not the bazaar, he's a very naughty boy.
Comedy albums.
I wanted to be a lumberjack.
Several books and, of course, a stage show.
People who can sing and dance often at the same time.
And now for something completely different. Cleese and Idle are back together again at last for the very first time. What? In a new stage show, which kicks off today.
Eric Idle, John Cleese, welcome to Studio 10. Welcome back to Australia as well.
Did he ever overround?
I don't know.
Did he call you John?
He might have done.
No, I just said Eric Idle, John Cleese, welcome to Studio 10.
All right, then that was all right.
I thought he did all right.
Yeah,
I mean, you might want to do another one, of course. You could do it more better, but, you know.
Billy Idol, Elton John, welcome back to Studio 10.
Are you the brain specialist?
What are we going to see in the show?
Just generally disappointment.
Yes.
You'll end up leaving bitter and sad and life will seem pointless to you.
So like panto then?
It's sort of like panto.
Constantly
like a German panto.
Working their way along the lines and everyone's doing that.
Yeah.
You know, it's a very disappointing show. And a nation lies in shock.
Why are we here? You're going to be doing some of the sketches that people know, but I'll also...
No!
No.
Important.
You do not.
No.
There's nothing you will recognise.
Please let me finish the questions. You'll be doing a lot of sketches that people don't even recognise. Things from at last the 1948 show, things
there
like that.
There you are.
That's right.
You
That's
see...
Right.
Because
there's nothing from the O2 show at all.
So what was it like for the people actually at the show? Were they applauding like it was your Frank Sinatra concert? I know this, it's the nudge-nudge sketch.
There's a certain amount of recognition, of course, wasn't there? But there was a lovely feeling, because we started off in the TARDIS, or the retardis, as we called it. And, you know, we're waiting inside the ding-ding-a-ding-ding, and to coming out, you just felt them just go nuts. And I knew they would go nuts.
You see, the thing about being a comic is that you're always scared that you're going to make a fool of yourself. As Eric was saying to me earlier, he was saying comics talk about killing the audience or dying themselves, you know what I mean? And when you go out there, and you just feel terrible if you try to be funny and they don't laugh. So there's always that anxiety. But as you get older, what happens, even if doing my one-man show, Eric, and I'm doing the two-man, is that people think, well, we like them, so we'll buy some tickets. So they're pre-selected to like us. They don't say we can't stand those two, let's buy six tickets. If you're doing a one-man show all the time, it's a lot of talking.
You're always with yourself, you can't get away.
Yeah, that's
you've got to go and have dinner with yourself. And occasionally, if you're lucky, have sex with yourself. But I mean, you know, at least we did.
Now, are you a bedwetter? Sorry? Are you a bedwetter?
Well, not since I'm...
Right, well, you sit on a chair, I'll lie on the couch.
In At Last, the 1948 show, you weren't originally on that, or were you?
I was in tiny little parts, because I was just down from Cambridge, and they gave me little roles, which was lovely. I'd play the hand holding the gun, or the dead body, or the... So
we always knew you'd get it right. You wouldn't need any rehearsal. So you actually turned up in a lot of the shows.
And it was very pleasant. We were only doing peripheral things, so there was nothing to be nervous about. Mm. So I got very comfortable about being in a TV studio.
Always look on the bright side of life.
All the funny songs in Python, you just don't realise that there are so many funny songs.
And I got to put it together, actually. I had a sudden brainstorm. I think, oh, we should do Monty Python Sing. So I got everything we'd ever recorded and I made a nice edited album. And that sold out 10 times more than any of our other albums.
Did it really?
Because you can't listen to the cheese sketch every morning.
No.
But you can put on a song.
Every sperm is sacred.
got away with playing a couple of times Every Sperm is Sacred on BBC London.
Did you?
Yeah, until someone said, is that about sperm?
And now for something completely different.
It's only a wafer thing.
Know what I mean? Say no more.
I know that you didn't go out of your way, or did you, to write catchphrases.
He asked him knowingly.
All those things are now in the vernacular, whether it's the TV shows or the movies.
It's never intentional. You see, what catches, you never know what's going to catch on.
Look! Just a flesh wound.
Well, there were six writers, and you didn't know which writers were on. They were changing constantly.
Right.
And just because we were in the scene, it didn't mean we wrote it. For example, I had that wonderful monologue you guys wrote, The Travel Agent.
And he drones on and on and on about how Mr. Smith should be running this country, and how many languages Enoch Powell can speak, and he throws up all over the Cuba.
Now, I got that, because then nobody wants to learn the f***ing thing. It was all set up by the brilliant writing of that rant, which, again, just goes on and on. You can't believe it's going to keep going.
There was a few extra rants in the parrot sketch.
Oh, yeah, but Michael and I used to say whatever came into our heads at the end of that sketch.
And vroom, vroom, vroom. Matey, this parrot wouldn't vroom if you put 40,000 volts through it. It's bleeding demise.
The English theatre critics didn't get the O2 show. Because how often do you go to a show where you know the jokes? You see, it's an extraordinary thought. There were a lot of people in the audience who knew the lines better than we did. That's completely unlike going to the theatre normally. So it was an emotional experience to do with the fact that they were thanking us for making them laugh for 40 years, and we were thanking them for thanking us. And the material felt funny anyway. Yeah. It was a wonderful atmosphere.
Do you want to come back to my place? I thought he'd never ask. Oh.
Is life... You're not going to do that thing at the end of the show where you actually killed someone in the audience, like you did in the
Americas. Well, we said we won't.
You know, I had actually killed a man. Did you know?
Really?
He was a dentist in Aarhus in Denmark, and he was famous for his convulsive laugh, and he went to see Fish Called Wanda, not Python, and he started laughing about 20 minutes in and never stopped, till he didn't. Stop.
Aww. Really?
Yes, had to be carried out of the stall stone dead.
Did he get his money back?
He got his teeth back.
Hazelnut, nougat, caramel, chocolate. Right down the middle. Mm. I like it. Say no more.
Well, one of the first reasons I came to Australia was that Eric had done a set of commercials for a biscuit.
That's right. That's where I came over here. And then I had a very nice time, 3 weeks, and paid very well. Thank you very much, January. And then they said, oh, come back and do some more. I said, oh, no, I don't want to go back. I've done, you know, I'm on something else at the moment. So he came and did it.
Yes.
He played my brother.
Suck it in one.
What do you think we should end the interview now?
Maybe a song.
A song, Eric?
I prefer lunch.
What about a song and then lunch? And a nudge bar.
Say no more.
Say no more.
And always look on the bright side of life.
Can't wait to see that show. I wonder if we'll ever actually find out what the airspeed velocity of a swallow is. Still wondering.
Well done, Jono.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well done them. Well done them. Go and see their show. Please and Idle. Plenty of tickets left. They paid me to say that, by the way.